Thank you very much for coming to the Center of European Studies this afternoon for this discussion we are having. May I briefly introduce myself? I'm not the host here at CES. My name is Ralph Horlemann. I'm the German Consul General here to Boston. I recently arrived to Boston, so many of you will not know my face yet. I have to thank the organizers here at CES having invited me to say a few introductory remarks, which I have happily accepted. The month of October for us is kind of German Unity Month. We've had the 25th anniversary of German unification on Saturday, 3rd of October. We have opened a photo exhibition on that occasion at the MIT Museum. And there's a whole range of cultural and other activities in the month of October, many of them here at the Goethe Institute. So for us, this is month of German unity. And if you've read the newspapers and what followed the media in the last weeks, you will probably have noticed that this is also, these are weeks and months of, how shall I say, European disunity, maybe. I'm referring in particular to the migration issue, which was really in the forefront here. Germany receiving a lot of positive comments on the decision to take in so many refugees, critical views on the EU. And so we have this unity theme and also maybe a little bit of discussion and disunity. And having Barbara Klemm here today, which is a great privilege, with her photographs documenting decades of German separation and disunity. On Saturday, I said in a speech that until we concluded the Grundlagenvertrag, this basic treaty between the two Germanies, there were no relations between the two Germanies, as Egon Bahr has put it at the time, and after that, at least, there were bad relations. And on the 2nd of October, so 1990, one day before German unification came about, the head of our mission in East Berlin, Ständige Vertretung, could report to the Foreign Office, and that was the last report he wrote before he closed down the whole mission, saying, well, now after all these years, I can say we have very good relations to the GDR, but he continued, starting from tomorrow, we don't need them anymore. So we have a very good documentation and artful documentation of decades of German separation and also of the theme of unity. And this makes CES, the Center for European Studies, the best possible location I could think of to host this exhibition and also this symposium here. So I would like to thank you all for coming. And now hand over to Professor Mary Elise Sarotte. Thank you very much for listening.
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you very much. And I would also like to say thank you to the Goethe Institute Boston. The Goethe Institute is partnering with CES to bring you Frau Klemm's photographs. Part of the exhibit is here in the room next to us, and we will be seeing them very soon. And part of the exhibit is at the Goethe Institute. And so we encourage you, if you are interested, to please also go to the Goethe Institute as well to see the marvelous photos at the Institute as well. And the CES and the Goethe Institute would also like to thank the Institute für Ausländer Beziehungen, an institute that has helped to co-sponsor this event as well. So I have been very excited about this evening, but also slightly terrified ever since Elaine Bafoulias and Gila Naderi of the Center for European Studies approached me and asked me if I would moderate this event. excited because I know so many of Frau Klemm's images from my own work on political history, my own research into the fall of the Berlin Wall and the process of German unification. I knew them without even knowing they were your images. So it is a great honor to meet the person who has created those images. But I was also terrified because her work, which often shows politicians in an utterly astonishing intimacy, despite the formality of the context in which she's captured them, is important not just politically, but also artistically. And it was far beyond my abilities to give proper due to the artistic value of her photographs. And so when I was asked to do this, I said, only if I can please contact my former fellow from the American Academy in Berlin, Benjamin Buchloh, Mellon professor here at Harvard University at the Department of Art and Art History. Also, although I'm not supposed to say this, one of the most important art critics in the world, in my opinion, the most important critic of 20th and 21st century art in the world. I said, I'm only going to do this if I can ask Benjamin to talk about the artistic merits of her work. That is far more than I possibly can do. And Benjamin, it must have been a weak moment because Benjamin said yes.
No, I tell you what.
Made time in his busy schedule to come and honor us at this event, thus linking the many of the designed aspects at Harvard and political aspects at Harvard, which often are separated. It's a shame. And I hope they can come together more often in the future. So I hope you're in a very special evening. And even after we are done talking, there will be yet more special events to come. Professor Charles Mayer and Christoph Michler of the Goethe Institute have kindly offered to make a few remarks and lead us in a toast to formally open the exhibit next door. And then after that, there will be a reception with lovely things to eat upstairs. So we will talk here until about 5:45 or so, and then we will go next door and have a toast, and finally we will go upstairs and have something to eat. So if there is perhaps not time to ask a question during the discussion, please rest assured there will be many options and opportunities for asking questions at the exhibit and upstairs afterward as well. But I will try to leave a little bit of time for questions as well. On one technical note, Frau Klemm does understand English but would prefer not to speak it. We are fortunate to have Herr Großkopf with us returning, who will help to translate when Frau Klemm requests it, either things she wants to say or if she has not understood a question. But you should feel free to pose a question, either in German or in English, and as need be, Herr Großkopf will translate. So an introduction of Frau Klemm is not necessary, but I would like to make one nonetheless. Frau Klemm had an astonishing career, and still has an astonishing career, working as a photographer for the Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, a major Frankfurt newspaper. She has worked there for 35 years. Impressively, she actually started working there at age 19. And that was after beginning a training as a photographer at age 15. She was one of those fortunate people who knew at a very early age what she wanted to do. She was, it goes without saying, the only woman working in this capacity at the Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung. And she gradually rose through the ranks, and as they say, the rest is history, which you can see documented in the exhibit next door. I asked her which of her many prizes and accomplishments she would like me to mention in this introduction, and she asked me to refrain and only to mention one prize that meant a great deal to her, and that prize is the Erich Salomon Prize. That prize, named for Erich Salomon, honors a major photographer of the Weimar era. This photographer was also able to capture politicians in moments of surprising intimacy in formal contexts. And Frau Klemm said that these images inspired her in her own work, and in many ways her work is very similar to that of Erich Salomon. Tragically, Erich Salomon, though he fled to Holland, was not able to escape the Nazis, and he and his family perished in Auschwitz. But in his honor, the Deutsche Gesellschaft für Fotografie, the German Society for Photography, together with Leica cameras, founded a prize, and Frau Klemm is one of the holders of the Erich Salomon Prize. I will resist listing her many other awards in the interest of getting this evening going. We first will be treated to a few comments from Benjamin about the history of photography from the Weimar era and the way that that has continued and not into the era of the Bundesrepublik, the Federal Republic of Germany. I will then make just a few very, very brief comments about the Cold War context of Frau Klemm's photos, but the bulk of today will consist of a discussion, a conversation between the three of us, looking at some of the images that you will be able to inspect more closely for yourself in the exhibit afterwards. I've picked a handful of photos that appeared to me to be politically important. Benjamin Buchloh has picked images that he considers to be striking visual images. We've discussed these with Frau Klemm, and we will basically have a conversation about these images as we display them on the side screens, and in no particular formal order. So Benjamin, if you would be so kind,
okay, to start. Thank you, Mary. I guess this is a good example of whether one should be careful trusting historians when they give a description of what one does. So, but thanks anyway. there's one detail that I want to correct. It was utter serendipity of the most wonderful kind that you asked me to come to this event, because my admiration and love for Barbara Klemm's work is long-standing but anonymous, in the sense that I've never written about her, I've never met her, but I've looked and loved the photographs for a long time for various reasons. So when you asked me, it was totally serendipitous, wonderful coincidence that this worked out. Anyway, so in the short preparation conversation that I had with Barbara Klemm this morning, one of my first questions was, how does one become a photographer in Germany in the 1950s, when photography in Germany had largely been, like psychoanalysis, eradicated and destroyed by fascism. And most of the great photographers had emigrated. And I asked her, what was your relationship to that generation of photographers? What did you know about Giselle Freund? What did you know about Ellen Auerbach? What did you know about Grete Stern? What did you know about Ilse Bing? Figures that we now, in the last 10 years or so, have only slowly, or some of us probably earlier, or in more detail, rediscovered and recognized in terms of what this extraordinary formation of largely female photographers, Lotte Jacobi, I should have mentioned as well, had developed as a culture, photographic culture in Germany, that in many ways I would argue is, in my mind, at least, if not more important than many of the painterly products that came out of Weimar Germany. So, and typically, she said, well, Ellen Auerbach was a friend of my mother. And Ellen Auerbach came to visit us, and I met Ellen Auerbach early on, and she came back to Germany because she visited our family on regular visits. And so there was already an answer to my question that, of course, there was a deep connection. Not everybody might have had that type of a direct friend and familial connection as she has had. And of course, not surprisingly, Barbara Klemm's work is obviously coming out of that repressed history, out of that destroyed history of German photography, as one can tell from the photographs, as one studies them. And then the next question that I asked, and still think is important to understand, is how do you respond to the division of the photographic traditions as they were formulated in the 1920s and 1930s in Germany? On the one hand, photoreportage, which is in a way what you do, and on the other hand, the great figures of Neue Sachlichkeit photography like August Sander and Albert Wenger-Partsch as the key figures. And clearly, Barbara Klemm said, no, well, I knew about both of them. Of course, they were both important for me and for my formation, but it was really the reportage tradition like Alfred Eisenstadt and Eric Salomon that formed me in those early stages. And when I asked about when did this happen, and quite typically for my, since we are almost the same generation, in fact, we are the same generation, not before the early 1970s, which is really interesting to recognize that the reception and the recognition of photographic culture does not begin in West Germany before the 1970s on a kind of broader level. So that is also the moment when, of course, Bernd and Hilla Becher begin their teaching activities at the Düsseldorf Academy, which then will become such a central project, and the generations of two generations of disciples that the Bechers have brought into the world is an kind of obvious proof to that, but it is really not, and this is quite interesting for us to recognize, it's not until the early 1970s that the rediscovery of the photographic culture of Weimar Germany begins at that moment for you as well, right?
Yeah, aber ich wollte noch auf Ihre Frage oder auf Ihre Feststellung kommen, dass Sie gesagt haben, zu meiner Zeit gab es keine Frauen.
But I would like to come back to your remark about the fact that at the time when I was starting, there were no women.
Erstaunlich ist aber, dass eben in den 20er Jahren sehr viele Frauen.
That's what I said. I said, yeah. Well,
surprisingly, in the 1920s, there were quite a few women in this field of photography.
Und ich glaube, dass dass es erst schon wieder angefangen hat, in der journalistischen Fotografie interessant zu werden oder man mehr gearbeitet hat nach dem Krieg, war doch der Beginn der Studentenbewegung. Zumindest war das für mich der Auslöser.
And I think it was the beginning of the student movement in Germany, in West Germany. At least that was the occasion for me when we started to once again pick up on this journalistic photo tradition.
Weil das hat uns junge Leute damals sehr politisiert und das war das, wo man gedacht hat, ja, man muss was festhalten. Also ich habe für meine Arbeit war es, dass ich was sah, was ich machen musste und wo ich dachte, das muss man zeigen, was da passiert, habe aber sehr schnell, also ich war sehr involviert gewesen und habe gemerkt, dass das für die Fotografien gar nicht so gut ist.
Well, this movement politicized us all when it started, and I was personally carried along with it and became interested in capturing those moments. In the long run, however, I had also had to find that this event may not have been altogether that positive in that respect.
Weil man sich zurücknehmen muss, wenn man gut arbeiten möchte.
Because if you want to do good work as a photographer, you don't have to, you cannot be involved or in the foreground. You have to take yourself back into the background.
Perhaps I should.
Go ahead, yeah.
Perhaps we could, Paul, perhaps show one of the first images, because these images are actually from the 1970s. Just briefly for context, Germany, of course, was a divided country for much of Frau Klemm's career. As an unintended consequence of the 1945 victory of the four powers, the United States, Britain, France, and the Soviet Union, they found themselves basically sharing an occupation of Germany, an occupation that became increasingly controversial as the Western Allies tried to institute democratic institutions in the West, and in the East, the Soviet Union resisted actual democratization in favor of essentially Soviet control. And perhaps the most striking visual image of this division was, of course, the Berlin Wall, built in 1961, and it stood until 1989. So I assume the student movement you're talking about the West German and West Berlin student movement, because this was in the 60s and 70s after the division of Germany. And this image is from the year of 1977. It shows Berlin Kreuzberg. And I wanted to have this image just to remind us all of the German division. It's, of course, it ended when the Berlin Wall came down 25 years ago last autumn. German unification happened 25 years ago Sunday. So these events have receded from memory, but are still very present, I think, in the hearts and minds of many who lived through them, not so much in the younger generation, which lives with the consequences. So I wanted to bring up this image and perhaps ask you a little bit about your photography of the wall. What kind of challenge was it to try to capture images, try to capture this division in photographs?
Also ich war nicht Natürlich, ich war nicht in Berlin stationiert, sondern in Frankfurt. Und wenn es irgendetwas Interessantes gab, hat die Zeitung mich nach Berlin geschickt.
I wasn't based in Berlin. I was based in Frankfurt. But when anything interesting was happening, the newspaper would send me to Berlin.
Und da ich eigentlich immer versucht habe, außerhalb der Termine, die ich machen musste, zu gucken, was es so gibt. Also ich habe so eine Art gab, man schlendert durch die Stadt und beobachtet.
And my way has always been, in addition to the set appointments that I had to go to and take photos at, to basically take a stroll through the environment, through the city, and see what I could find.
Und so sah ich diese Szene. This is how I
discovered that scene. This was not an ordered photograph that I had to take. I just came across it.
Natürlich war es immer deprimierend, die Mauer zu sehen und das erste Bild, was sie draußen vielleicht gesehen haben, als sie reinkamen, dieser wunderbare Engel, der gehört zum Reichstag, und dann sehen sie einen Wachturm und das die Mauer und das Brandenburger Tor.
Well, it is always depressing to have to look at this Berlin Wall. Maybe even more so when you look at that photograph that is now up, where you see the sculpture of the angel, which is part of the Reichstag, the Parliament building in Germany, and in the background the watchtower that marks the separation of the city.
Das war zum Beispiel ein Auftrag für einen Artikel für Jobs Siedler, der ein Buch geschrieben hat und etliche Artikel für die Zeitung für uns.
That was a photo that I was asked to take by Jobs Siedler, who wrote several articles for our newspaper about the topic.
Do you want to say something,
Benjamin,
about this?
No, it's okay.
No. And then I assume, let me go back to an image that the East Side Gallery has made famous. You see here in this image the Soviet leader Leonid Brezhnev kissing Erich Honecker, the leader of East Germany. This is not because of their personal relationship. This is a display of power politics in a very unusual form. In German, this is known as the Bruderkiss, the brotherly kiss, and it was de facto one of the more unusual signs of Soviet domination, that when a Soviet leader would visit socialist countries, he, and it was always a he, would inflict this upon the local socialist leader. And this image, there are other ones as well. Often it would happen when the Soviet plane landed on the tarmac in an airport, has been now memorialized in Berlin in the East Side Gallery, painted on the remnants of the wall, right, and has thus become one of the most famous images from the Cold War period. So I'd be interested to know a little bit about the experience of taking this photograph.
Ja, da muss ich Ihnen was erzählen, was vielleicht das klarzustellen, was das mit der East Side Gallery zu tun hat.
Aha, okay. Well, und mit dem Kuss. Let me tell you something about that and clarify maybe what this has got to do with the East Side Gallery.
Also als erstes ist das Bild entstanden bei einem Empfang, den Honecker Brezhnev gegeben hat zum 30. Jahrestag der DDR.
So the actual photo was taken at a reception that Erich Honecker, the East German leader, was giving for Leonid Brezhnev, the Russian leader, on the occasion of the 30th anniversary of the German Democratic Republic.
This is 1979.
Ja. Entschuldigung. Und da waren natürlich ganz viele Kollegen gewesen, nicht nur ich alleine. Das ist, wie Sie das sicher aus dem Fernsehen kennen, immer ein Pulk von Menschen.
So there were quite a few photographers, not just me, who were there allowed to take photographs.
Und ein Kollege, Jean Regis Bossu, ein französischer Fotograf, war zu spät gekommen.
And a fellow of mine, a French photographer, was late.
Und er hatte noch, wie Sie hier hinten, ein langes Teleobjektiv auf seiner Kamera, obwohl das in einem geschlossenen Raum eigentlich gar nicht zu benutzen ist.
And he still had a long tele lens mounted on his camera, which you don't need in a small indoor setting like this.
Und er hat im selben Moment wie ich dieses Bild gemacht, aber ein Close-up, wo man den Kuss natürlich noch viel, wir sagen dazu eigentlich einen Schmatzkuss, noch viel, also richtig groß rauskam.
And actually, he shot the same photograph as I did at the same moment, only he had this telelens on, so it became a close-up. And so the actual kiss was even more prominent.
Und dieser Kuss ist auf der Mauer zu sehen.
Yeah. And that is the kiss you see in the East Side Gallery.
Aber für mich ist bei so einem Auftrag oder bei so einem politischen Ereignis immer viel interessanter, sozusagen mehr zu zeigen, also nicht nur ein Detail zu machen, sondern Sie sehen zum Beispiel Gromyko und Chanyenko, der dann der Nachfolger von Brezhnev wurde.
At such events, it is always important for me to not just show a detail. I also wanted to show context, and if you look at this photograph, you will see in the background Andrei Gromyko and Chanyenko, who later followed Brezhnev.
Und die sprechen miteinander und interessieren sich gar nicht für den Kuss, aber das Politbüro ist natürlich dabei, diese wunderbare Szene zu beklatschen.
And you can see those two Soviet politicians talking to each other, not very interested in the actual kissing going on, whereas all the members of the East German political bureau are clapping their hands.
The two Soviet politicians are on the far right of the photo.
Gromyko and Chanyenko. Just a technical question, if you don't mind. Mm-hmm. Was it difficult to get permission to be present as a West German photojournalist at this ceremony? In proximity to the head of state?
Nein, in diesem Fall nicht. Also bei den Jahresfeiern war das einfach und man konnte zur Leipziger Messe ein Visum bekommen als Journalist oder Fotograf und für die Ostseewoche.
Okay.
No, there were a few occasions in East Germany where it was a little bit easier to get a visa as a Western journalist to take photos. This was one of them, and the anniversary of the country, as well as the Leipzig Trade Fair and a festival held annually at the Baltic Sea coast.
Actually, if we are asking technical questions, can I ask you about your cameras? What cameras you preferred? What lenses you preferred?
Also ich würde sagen, das ist ziemlich nebensächlich.
I would say that is rather unimportant.
Aber ich kann es Ihnen gerne beantworten. Yeah. Ich habe eigentlich immer mit einer Spiegelreflexkamera gearbeitet.
But I can easily answer that question. Of course, I've always worked with an SLR camera.
Weil man damit am schnellsten arbeitet und dabei hat man natürlich ein paar am liebsten ein Zoom, in dem man sehr schnell den Ausschnitt in dem Moment festlegen kann.
Because you can really work very fast with that type of camera, and what is also important, you have a zoom function which enables you to very quickly select the focus or the frame that you actually want to shoot at.
Und so am Ende der 80er Jahre habe ich eine Leica bekommen.
And at the end of the 1980s, I got a Leica camera.
Und das ist eine Sucherkamera, mit der man sehr langsam nur arbeiten kann.
This is a camera type where you must work slower.
Und man arbeitet da ganz anders. Ich benutze sie eigentlich fast nur in den Räumen.
And it's a completely different kind of taking photos. I actually use that camera only indoors.
Wo ich beobachten kann und in aller Ruhe Dinge, man fällt nicht so auf wie mit einer größeren Spiegelreflexkamera.
Where I can observe and use the camera, which is not quite as prominent as an SLR camera would be.
Und für mich ist es immer wichtig gewesen, möglichst dass man mich nicht merkt, also dass man mich gar nicht sieht.
And it has always been important for me that people at best, do not notice that I'm there.
Weil ich sehr gerne es so festhalten möchte, wie ich es beobachte und die Situation sehe. Also ich habe so gut wie nie etwas arrangiert.
Because I would like to have photographs that show exactly what happens and without taking any notice of me. And so I hardly ever arranged a photograph.
Und das ist auch das, wo man sich selber eben sehr zurücknehmen muss.
And this is what I said earlier, that this is that the photographer has to take himself or herself back.
Und dann kommt dazu, ich bin sehr viel im Osten gereist, also in Russland, in Polen, in Rumänien.
And in addition, I also traveled a lot in the Eastern Bloc, in Russia, in Poland, in Romania.
Und da habe ich eigentlich nie mich geoutet, dass ich eine Fotografin bin.
And there I never told anyone. I never outed myself as a photographer.
Ich bin gelaufen wie ein Tourist oder wie jemand, der durch die Straßen schlendert, und habe immer mal drauf gedrückt.
I walked around like a tourist, took a photo here and there.
Und war dadurch nicht für die Leute gefährlich.
And this did not look suspicious or dangerous to the people there.
Und das hat mir sehr viele Dinge ermöglicht. Und wenn jemand irritiert war, ein bisschen gelächelt, und dann war das.
And this gave me many opportunities. And if someone showed some irritation, I would just smile at them, and usually it passed.
Aber das, dieses Laufen und Schlendern funktioniert nur, wenn man ganz konzentriert ist, und man muss es natürlich alleine machen.
And this walking around and strolling around will only work, of course, if you're highly focused and you have to be on your own.
Das war gar nicht so nebensächlich. That was not so unimportant.
Yeah, I was a little, ich war etwas überrascht, gerade als Sie sagten, die Leica macht die Arbeit langsamer. Der Mythos der Leica war ja in den 20er Jahren, als sie erfunden wurde, dass das die schnellste Kamera war, die alle Künstler in Deutschland, in Russland, in Frankreich wollten eine Leica benutzen, weil das der ganz hervorragende Schnelligkeit erlaubte.
I was somewhat surprised to hear you say that using a Leica camera forces you to work slower, because in the 1920s, when the Leica camera was first came up, it was the big hit among most photographers, because they praised its being so fast.
Ja, aber es gab natürlich noch keine Spiegelreflexkamera.
Okay. Yes, but at that time there was no single lens SLR camera.
Und sie hatten diese noch diese Kameras, die sie zum Teil mit Balken, die sie bewegen mussten. Also die, wenn Sie die frühen Fotografen sehen, wie die da alle stehen mit Blitzlicht oben drauf, Balkenkamera in der Hand.
And you had still had these old-fashioned cameras where something, where there were bars at the front and a tripod and the lights separate and things like that.
Yeah. So I would like now to, did you want to say something else about this picture?
I think, nein, ich denke, das haben, da haben wir drüber gesprochen. Also für mich war das bei dem Auftrag sehr schwer, den Reich, was Job Siedler gerne wollte, den Reichstag und das Brandenburger Tor auf das Bild zu bekommen. Da der Wald dazwischen war und die Mauer war, habe ich mir dann mich beholfen, indem ich einfach nur ein Detail vom Reichstag genommen habe.
Yeah.
Und ich glaube, das ist viel schöner, als wenn man den schweren Kasten irgendwie.
Yes, we talked basically about that. Just to add to that, the person who asked me to take the photograph actually wanted to have the Brandenburger Tor and the Reichstag building, the Parliament building, in one photograph. And that is absolutely hard to do, because there is a little forest in between. They are not really right next to each other, those two buildings. And this is why I focused on a detail rather than showing the entire building. And this is what it became, the angel of the Parliament building, the Brandenburg Gate in the background, and the wall in between.
And of course, those of you who have visited Berlin today know, of course, that the wall is gone. It's hard for many tourists who just freely walk through the Brandenburg Gate to the Reichstag to believe that the wall actually threaded itself behind the back of the Reichstag and then in front of the Brandenburg Gate, which you see in the distance here. Well, then I, as a political historian, would be very interested to hear more about this picture. I could, of course, talk until everyone here falls asleep about 1989. I've written two books about it, but I will restrain myself. Basically, in the fall of 1989, there was both a revolution from below, a peaceful revolution, following in large part in the footsteps of Solidarity in Poland. East German activists organized effectively within East Germany. But there was also a revolution from above, started by Mikhail Gorbachev, the man in the center of this picture, who was the leader of the Soviet Union. This picture is from the fall of 1989. We saw previously a picture from the 30th anniversary of East Germany. Anniversaries proved to be very tricky for East Germany. This photo is from the 40th anniversary of East Germany. And anniversaries were tricky precisely because of people such as yourself. The East German regime, as part of its effort to legitimize itself, wanted as many journalists as possible, as many photojournalists as possible, to come to the anniversaries. But the problem is that having those foreign journalists in the country meant that they also had opportunities to take photos that perhaps were not exactly what the East regime wanted. And Mikhail Gorbachev received a very warm welcome from the East German population, a reception with genuine warmth in it, which was in stark contrast to earlier receptions of Soviet leaders, which were very staged, very micromanaged. Gorbachev received a very warm reception. He took part in a number of conversations. And he also reportedly told Erich Honecker, the hardline East German leader, "He who comes too late will be punished by life. He who comes too late will be punished by life." This somewhat enigmatic statement was taken to be a hint from Gorbachev to Honecker that Honecker needed to institute reforms as well, of the kind that Gorbachev was introducing, or else he, Honecker, would be overtaken by events, as he indeed was a month later when the Berlin Wall fell. So this picture is part of this amazing visit from Mikhail Gorbachev to East Germany, East Berlin, in October 1989. The anniversary itself was October 7th, 1989. And Erich Honecker still decided, despite all of the revolutionary activities, to stage a large parade in honor of East Germany and to have Mikhail Gorbachev attend. And he was then surprised when people at this staged affair started spontaneously chanting, "Gorby, Gorby, Gorby." So this was a very, very awkward moment for the leader of a country whose motto was "learning from the Soviet Union means learning victory." Von der Sowjetunion lernen heißt Siegen lernen. So this was a very, very uncomfortable moment for Erich Honecker. And you, of course, were there in the middle of all of it. So I would just be interested to hear about the experience of being there and of this photo, the experience of seeing that reception of Gorbachev in East Berlin.
Ja, ich hatte keine Akkreditierung bekommen für die Kranzniederlegung in der Wache, die Gorbachev
I did not get an accreditation to be able to be present at the laying of the wreath at the memorial, war memorial, that where Gorbachev was present.
So habe ich mich gegenüber wie alle anderen interessierten Leute auf die Straße gestellt und habe gedacht, mal gucken, vielleicht kann ich was machen.
So like everyone else who was not admitted to that event, I was standing on the other side of the street and was thinking by myself, let's see what happens and maybe there's an opportunity to do something.
Und dann war es so, wie Sie gesagt haben, die jungen Leute riefen Gorbi, Gorbi, und kam über die Straße.
And then it happened exactly as you said, the young people were enthusiastic and they were calling out Gorbi, Gorbi, and so Mikhail Gorbachev crossed the street and came over to us.
Und da sagte diesen Satz, der immer mal etwas anders übersetzt wird. Und ich stand nebendran, sagte zu einem jungen Mann.
And this is when he said that very sentence, "He who is late will be punished by life." There are more translations than that one. And he said it to a young man standing there.
Und es waren auch schon schreibende Kollegen dabei. Und wie ich hinterher hörte, haben die gesagt, das ist ein Ausspruch. Also jetzt irgendetwas wird passieren. Also die haben den Eindruck gehabt, es kommt was in Bewegung.
And this is when many of the writing guild who were also present in that on that scene were getting the feeling that this is a very important statement and that some change is imminent right now.
Und am Abend gab der Honecker ein Abendessen und Gorbachev ist vorzeitig abgereist.
And Honecker, the East German leader, gave a dinner, an honorary dinner, on that evening, and Gorbachev went home early.
Und es gab ich glaube, es war am selben Tag, eine Demonstration von den Ostdeutschen vor dem Palast der Republik, haben sie geschrien, und danach gab es eine sehr große Schlägerei, bei der ich mich dann zurückgezogen habe, also ich war nie so ganz mutig.
And on that same day there was a huge crowd of people in front of that very place where the dinner was being held, the Palace of the Republic, it was called. And later on, there was some beatings going on with the security forces. I was no longer among them. I wasn't all that courageous.
Is that the day when you took the Babel Bully photographs? Is that the demonstration? When you bought this photo with Babel Bully?
Nein,
das ist ein anderer Tag.
Nein, das war eine richtige. Die haben die Leute richtig mit Lastwagen, wie man das vom Schneepflug sonst her kennt, hatten sie vor die Lastwagen gemacht, die Soldaten und oder das Militär oder wer auch immer es war, und haben die Leute vor sich hergeschoben. Und
no, that was this other photograph that he was referring to was mm-hmm. taken at a different occasion, but on that very evening the crowds were shoved away like snow. They had trucks with snowplow-like shovels in front, mounted in front of them, and they were going into the people and shoving the crowd away.
It doesn't have Mühe. Okay.
The occasion she's talking about on the anniversary, on October 7th, the anniversary itself, as I mentioned, the East German regime wanted to present a happy face to the world, but journalists were supposed to leave immediately after the stage events, and then there was a very brutal repression of activists in the streets, including a man being run over by a truck, that actually happened on the evening of October 7th. One of the leading activists of the era was Bärbel Bohlen, the woman here you see in the foreground. She was sometimes known as the mother of the revolution. And this is part of a series of astonishing photos that you took. On this photo, you see not only Bärbel Bohlen, but also behind her, Gregor Gysi, who is a socialist leader. And then off to the right, I believe, is Heiner Müller. And in this photo sequence, you even, although not in this particular photo, in the sequence of photos, you even see Ulrich Mühe,
right,
the actor.
Which is the one that's not, it's not in here, isn't it?
Zwei Bilder gibt's.
Okay.
Ulrich Mühe is perhaps known to a younger generation best for his role in The Lives of Others, an actor who was in that movie as well. So perhaps you could talk a little bit about this photo.
Das war am 4. November, als die Künstler, die DDR-Künstler, eine große Demonstration gemacht haben.
This was on the 4th of November 1989, when East German artists held a major demonstration in Berlin's Alexanderplatz.
Und da kamen 500.000.
And it was attended by 500,000 people.
Und viele Reden wurden gehalten von allen möglichen Leuten, Schauspielern, unter diesen Bürgerrechtlern.
There were many speeches, civil rights activists, actors, artists were talking.
Das war es waren unglaubliche Schilder mit wunderbaren Sprüchen gegen die Regierung dabei.
And they also had interesting posters with unbelievable slogans against the government.
Und keiner wusste, ob auch da irgendjemand, ob das gut gehen wird oder nicht, oder ob wir einschreiten.
And no one had an idea if this was going to be a peaceful event or if at one point or another security forces would show up.
Und ich denke, durch die Masse haben sie sich das nicht getraut.
And I think it was the crowds that were there that nobody dared to order anyone in.
Ich habe dieses Foto und das andere, was mir noch wichtig erscheint, immer bewundert, weil zum einen sieht es so aus, und Sie sagten mir heute Morgen, das stimmt gar nicht, als seien Sie mit Bärbel Bohlen zum Beispiel bekannt gewesen. Es gibt eine Intimität der Interaktion als Fotografin und auch, dass Sie genau diese Leute gesehen haben, als hätten Sie genau gewusst, wer das ist. Wussten Sie denn, wer Ulrich Mühe ist? Wussten Sie denn, wer Heiner Müller ist? Wussten Sie denn, wer Bärbel Bohlen ist, als Sie das Foto aufgenommen haben? Waren das Freunde von Ihnen?
I've admired that photograph in particular because from a point of view of the artist, of the photographer, it looks as if you were friends with Bärbel Bohlen and you were aware of whose photos you are taking right here. Is that actually true? Did you know Bärbel Bohlen? Did you know Ulrich Mühe or anyone else in those photographs?
Nein, ich kannte die nicht, aber man hat auch, ich habe dann immer das, nicht immer, aber öfters das Glück, dass der Korrespondent die Leute kennt und wenn man zusammenarbeitet, dann geht das. Und er hat mir gesagt, dass Bärbel Bohlen das ist und Gregor Gysi war für mich gar kein Begriff gewesen. Und Der Heiner Müller hatte ich schon porträtiert gehabt in seiner Wohnung während der DDR-Zeit noch. Und den kannte ich.
Well, it's different. I mean, I did not know Bärbel Bohler. I did not even know who Gregor Gysi was at the time. But I was working with a journalist, and these guys have their background information. And I was told that is Bärbel Bohler by my colleague there. And I knew Heiner Müller because I had portrayed him before that.
You talked about how the mass of people overwhelmed the regime. In Leipzig on October 9th, and then at these events in November, it simply became too many people for the East German regime to resist. And of course, the most important night where there are too many people to resist is the night that the wall falls. So let me go back to a picture that you took on November 10th, 1989. This shows the Brandenburg Gate with the wall in front of it. This is very similar to the earlier image of the angel, but of course, a completely different mood. So I would be interested in hearing about your experience of November 9th and November 10th in Berlin.
Also ich meine, dass man als Fotograf diese Chance hatte, so ein wirkliches Ereignis, ein Jahrhundertereignis, muss man sagen.
Well, to have the opportunity as a photographer to actually be there at such a historic, centennial event, that was a great luck.
Also unsere Generation hat nie damit gerechnet, dass das passieren könnte.
To be frank, our generation never expected that they would see that happen.
Und so haben wir, mein Mann und ich, in der Nacht, als wir von einem Essen kamen, einfach mitbekommen, dass irgendetwas passiert ist.
And so my husband and I, coming home from eating out somewhere, we noticed, oh, something is going on.
Und da war für mich klar, morgen früh fliege ich nach Berlin. In der Nacht wäre man gar nicht mehr hingekommen.
I mean, I couldn't go right away. It was night, but I was telling him, I'm going to Berlin tomorrow.
Ja, es gab ja keine Flüge nachts und es gab keine. Den Transit war eine lange mühsame Geschichte.
There were no flights at night, and there was still, if you wanted to go by car, you had to go through East Germany with transit freeway, which was difficult through border patrols.
Und so kam ich um 10 an und habe den ganzen Tag gearbeitet.
And so I arrived in Berlin at 10 a.m. After the wall had been opened and worked the entire day.
Und Sie müssen sich überlegen, es gab keine Handys damals.
And just remember, there were no cell phones at the time.
Man wusste nicht, wo was passiert.
So you didn't know for sure where things are happening.
Alles war in Bewegung. Bekam keine Taxis, man musste, weil die Stadt einfach voll war.
Everything was in movement, in motion. You didn't even get a cab because the entire town was out on its feet.
Und das meiste passierte natürlich am Brandenburger Tor.
But most of the action was around the Brandenburg Gate.
Und wenn Sie genau gucken, sehen Sie an der rechten Seite eine kleine Leiter.
And if you look closely on the right-hand side in the picture, you'll see a small ladder.
Das war die einzige Leiter, die an diesem Stück Mauer stand.
That was the only ladder that somebody had put against
und
this piece of the wall.
Alle wollten hoch und gucken. Und natürlich ich auch. Wie sieht's an? Was passiert auf der Ostseite?
But everyone wanted to go up there and look what's going on the east side.
Und so bin ich mit Mühen dann nach oben.
And so I struggled and went up there.
Und da war eine sehr schöne Szene von standen die leider ist das Bild glaube ich in der Ausstellung ist es zu sehen. Die Soldaten waren es nicht, die Grenzbeamten an in einer Kette auf dem Boden.
And you see that image, it's another photo over there in the exhibition. It was a beautiful scene. There were the East German border police, the officers were standing there, lined up.
Und die Mädchen, die drauf waren, haben mit den Männern geflirtet und wollten unbedingt ein Autogramm auf dem Arm haben.
And the girls on the wall were flirting with them and asked them for an autograph.
Und traute sich aber nicht, dieser eine Beamte, weil immer sein Offizier vorbeilief.
But this one uniform guy didn't dare to do that because there was just an officer passing by in the back.
Es war wirklich also eine unglaublich euphorische Situation bei allen.
It was an unbelievably euphorical mood everywhere.
Und auch da ist mir eigentlich zugute gekommen, dass ich schon lange gearbeitet habe, 20, 30 Jahre.
And once again, it was my blessing that I had been in the job for 20 to 30 years.
Dass man dann wirklich sich nicht so anstecken lässt, sondern sehr genau hinguckt, um Bilder zu bekommen.
So I didn't let myself be carried away, but observed closely to shoot good photographs.
Die über die Zeit vielleicht halten.
That might become timeless or at least last through time.
Und da gehört noch eine kleine Geschichte dazu, wie ich dann plötzlich merkte, dass ich alle nach dem Westen wieder drehten, die auf der Mauer standen.
And there was a small side story. At one point I noticed that all of a sudden everyone was turning back around looking towards the West.
Und ich drehte mich dann auch und guckte, und es war Willy Brandt gekommen.
So I turned around myself and looked, and Willy Brandt had come to the Brandenburg Gate.
Und der damalige Bürgermeister Momper.
And the then mayor of West Berlin, Momper.
Und der gewesene Bürgermeister Stobbe.
And the former mayor of Berlin, Stobbe. All three of them were walking towards the wall.
Ich hätte natürlich gerne diese drei Herren mit dem Brandenburger Tor und mit den Massen gemacht, aber es war keine Möglichkeit, nach unten zu kommen.
And I would have loved to take a photo of these three gentlemen against Brandenburg Gate and all those people up there, but I had no way of getting down in time.
Aber es ist ein wunderbares Bild geworden, wo Brandt in der Mitte mit den beiden anderen steht und jede Figur, auch diese ganze Masse, die ihn umgeben, wunderbar zu sehen ist, weil es im Gegenlicht war.
But I was able to take a beautiful picture where Willy Brandt is shown kind of in the center of the photograph, but every other person is also in very good focus because it was photographed against the light.
Und da möchte ich sagen, also nicht umsonst haben wir früher Lichtbildner oder wurden wir Lichtbildner genannt, also ohne Licht ist es mit der Fotografie nicht ganz einfach. Aber ich habe trotz allem es immer versucht und habe nie geblitzt.
Oh.
Alle die ganzen 35 Jahre.
This is why in German originally photographers were called light image takers, stressing the fact that a light is a very important component in photography. But still, in all my 35 years, I have never used a flash.
Manchmal war es sehr sehr schwer.
Which was sometimes very hard.
Ja. Kann ich noch eine Fotografiegeschichte Frage stellen? Einfach mal.
May I ask a question about photography history?
The decisive moment, der entscheidende Augenblick. Sie haben gesagt, Henri Cartier-Bresson war eine ganz wichtige Figur für Sie. Wie ist denn das, wenn man als junge Frau in Deutschland in den 70er Jahren anfängt? Wie sind denn diese Einflüsse zusammengekommen? Also auf der einen Seite Cartier-Bresson als der wichtige Fotograf. Sie haben ihn auch versucht zu kontaktieren, haben Sie mir erzählt. Und dann auf der anderen Seite Ihre Bekanntschaft mit jemandem wie Ellen Auerbach, die ja eigentlich keine Fotografie Reportage praktiziert hat. Das war eine ganz andere Form von Fotografie eigentlich.
Nein,
ne?
Hat sie auch gemacht.
Später?
Ja.
Aber ursprünglich
hat sie Bauhaus.
Bauhaus gemacht, war Ringel und Piet mit Grete Stern. Und, und das sind also noch
Well, basically the question goes for the people she named as people who influenced her. The French photographer
Henri Cartier-Bresson,
and the person mentioned before,
Ellen Auerbach,
Ellen Auerbach, who, as the professor said, did not actually do photojournalism, but more or less was in the Bauhaus tradition, which you corrected. She did apparently also take some reportage photos.
So
and the how do these two influences come together, and how do they form a person like Barbara Klemm?
Oder war es auch Salomon und Eisenstadt als Vorbilder, um Fotografie, Reportage wieder zu beleben zu dem Zeitpunkt?
Or was the revival of the photo reportage more, had it more to do with Salomon and
Eisenstadt?
Also ich kann eigentlich nur sagen, erstmal muss man selber gucken, wie man die Sachen kriegt und findet.
Well, first and foremost, you have to find your way. You have to look for yourself and find your way.
Ich glaube, dass ich großes Glück hatte, dass ich in einer Familie groß geworden bin, wo meine Eltern beide Künstler waren.
I think I was very lucky to be raised in a family where both parents were artists.
Und so bin ich mit, das ist mein Vater am Fenster.
Here you can see my father at the window.
Und so bin ich mit Kunst eigentlich groß geworden.
So I grew up with art around myself.
Und ich unterrichte manchmal auch ein bisschen in einer Fachhochschule.
And sometimes I teach at a technical college.
Und motiviere die jungen Leute, in die Museen zu gehen.
And I try to motivate the young people to go into the museums.
Um zu sehen, wie die Maler die ihre Kompositionen legen.
To see how painters go about composing an image, a picture.
Um einen Blick dafür zu bekommen, das eventuell in der Wirklichkeit zu finden, wenn man fotografiert.
And to get the feeling how to translate such a composition into reality and find your composition there.
Weil es das ist etwas, was für uns viel schwieriger ist, für uns Fotografen, eine Komposition in ein Bild zu bekommen.
Because to include a proposition in a photograph is much harder than to put one into a painting.
Weil wir immer darauf angewiesen sind, was wir sehen, und jedes Mal bewegt sich jemand oder er steht nicht gerade da, wo man ihn haben möchte.
We always depend on what we see and the way it is arranged anyway, and of course it will not mostly not be the way you want it.
Aber ich sag auch immer, die eigentlichen Künstler sind natürlich die Maler.
But I do say that that the painters are the actual artists.
Weil wir sozusagen das ein Hilfsmittel haben und eigentlich versuchen etwas einzufangen, was der Maler mit einem unglaublichen Handwerk und ich weiß nicht, mit einer enormen Geduld hinkriegt.
Because we have all the tools and we capture something which takes the painter, the artists, a long time to compose and to bring to the screen.
Did you know this? I mean, you must know. I mean, this is sort of so straight out of Caspar David Friedrich.
Ja, aber es war ein Moment, den ich sah, als ich ihn besuchte und die Tür war offen. Und es gibt nur dieses eine Negativ.
It was one moment that I saw when the door was open and there was only this one negative.
Und das Thema war bei meinem Vater sehr auch das Fenster. Er hat sehr viel mit Fenstern gearbeitet.
And my father also had windows included in his work a lot.
This is a photo that you will actually find in the part of the exhibit at the Goethe Institute. Of course, it's very difficult to decide how to break up a complete exhibit, but because of limited space, it was not possible to have the complete exhibit in one place. And so various options, a decision was made to put the photos with a more political context here, and you will see them in the room when we go next door and have a toast with Professor Charlie Mayer. But there are a number of other photos, such as this of Frau Klemm's father. Perhaps we could also look at some of the photos of artists as well. Frau Klemm, of course, photographed not just political activists, but also a number of artists as well. We see here, for example, Joseph Beuys. Mm-hmm. Would you like to talk about this, or should I put up a photo of Gerhard Richter?
Well, it's okay. Richter is good. Either one is good.
Or this is a photo of Gerhard Richter, an artist.
Is that the Frankfurt installation?
This is Frankfurt. Yeah.
Benjamin Buchloh knows well and has written about extensively. Perhaps you could say a little bit about Gerhard Richter.
Yeah.
Well, it's quite remarkable, once again, for me, that you would have been there at this moment, because the Frankfurt exhibition was a very problematic exhibition, as you remember. Mm-hmm. It caused an extraordinary scandal.
What year was this? From the non-artist?
87.
1987,
yeah, okay. Right. And it was a particularly scandalous exhibition because Richter painted, for those of you who might not be familiar with the work, painted the members of the Bader-Meinhof group, mm-hmm. and in Frankfurt in particular, where the Bader-Meinhof group had caused tremendous pain and drama and tragedy, and by killing at least two bankers from the Frankfurt banking world, those paintings were perceived as an absolutely unacceptable homage, which was a misreading, of course, of Richter's work, an absolute scandalous homage to the legacy of the Bader-Meinhof group, which was the furthest from Richter's mind. But I'm surprised that you would have been there, that he was there at this moment, once again, this absolutely uncanny precision with which you seem to find the right moment, the right time, the right people. Yeah.
Aber das sind natürlich die Situationen, wo man auch immer mal ein bisschen Glück braucht. Ah. Also ich war im Haus und habe was anderes angehört. Das war ein Aufbau von den Kunstwerken und ich habe ihn zufällig in diesem Raum gesehen.
Okay. These are the situations where you just have to be lucky once in a while. I was in the building, I was doing photographing this and that, and all of a sudden he was standing there in the middle of the room. So I could take that photo.
Because Jean-Christoph Amand, as you yeah. will recall, was really under terrible pressure. There were even movements to ask him to take the paintings down, because the family was so wounded, and understandably so, that they thought this is absolutely unacceptable to have them on display. So it was a very complicated situation for Richter.
Das war es. Yeah. Und es wurde ja dann nach Amerika verkauft, diese ganze Serie.
Yes, it was a critical situation, but the whole series was sold to the US later.
Obwohl es natürlich unsere Geschichte ist.
Although it's actually really West German history.
Yeah. On that I can tell you, which he said, the paintings have been installed in Frankfurt for 20 years. Mm-hmm. In 20 years, not one German museum ever asked me about the paintings. Not once. He was very bitter about this because he wanted those paintings to be in Germany. And then the Museum of Modern Art came and asked him. And he said, sure.
Yeah.
Not one museum director ever asked him about the paintings because they were so charged with an absolutely unmanageable history. And I suppose that is the reason that nobody, Amann was courageous enough to have them in the museum, but it cost him quite a bit of sympathy in Frankfurt. So, yeah.
On the subject of being in a room with remarkable people, I'm wondering how you came across Andy Warhol.
That is genauso. Der Glücksfall.
That was a similar.
You seem to be very lucky.
I was always luck.
I think you are being too modest.
Yeah.
Da ich heute nicht, aber fast immer meine Kamera dabei habe.
Since I almost always have a camera with me, not today.
bin ich mit meinem Mann in Städel gegangen, das wunderbare Museum.
My husband and I went to the Städel, museum, a wonderful museum in Frankfurt, to look at some paintings.
Und da kamen wir in die Halle und es war eine kleine Gruppe von Männern da gestanden.
And we came into that hall and there was a small group of men.
Und ich fragte den Direktor Gallwitz.
And I asked the director, Mr. Gallwitz.
Weil ich nicht so ganz sicher war, ob es Warhol war oder nicht.
Because I wasn't even sure if it was Warhol or not.
Ich habe ihn vorher noch nie gesehen.
I hadn't seen him before.
Und er sagte, ja, ja. Und dann sag ich, und was macht er hier?
And he said, yes, that's him. And I asked him, so what's he doing here?
Und dann sagte er, er wollte sich das Bild von Tischbein, was
and
das Goethe zeigt.
He wanted to see that painting by a German painter Tischbein that shows German poet Goethe.
Wo er den Kopf nämlich von Goethe als Siebdruck mm-hmm. sehr oft hergestellt hat, aber er hatte nie das Original gesehen.
because he had produced Goethe's head as an offset print several times, but never seen the original painting.
Und außer mir war nur ein Fotograf, der den Termin kannte, dabei, und den musste ich fragen, wann ich das für richtig fand, darf ich da mich anschließen?
And there was only one other photographer who knew the event and the appointment present, and it is only polite to ask the colleague, may I tag along with you?
Und so habe ich ihn eigentlich arbeiten lassen und stand nur daneben und habe meine Bilder gemacht.
And so I let him do the work and I was just standing aside and did my own job.
So he had done the print before he saw the painting? He made the print from a reproduction?
Yeah, from a reproduction. Okay. Reproduction. Yeah.
Yeah. And now you're going to tell me that you met Albert Hitchcock by accident too?
Das war ein richtiger Termin. Oh,
okay.
No, that was an actual appointment.
Mit sehr vielen Kollegen.
With very many of my colleagues present.
Und er machte ein Frenzy, war der Film, der eingeführt wurde, und er machte etwas Promotion.
The movie that was introduced was the movie Frenzy.
Und er kam am Bahnhof an und man setzte ihn auf einen Regiestuhl, auf einen beweglichen Unterteil.
So he arrived at the railroad station and they put him into a director's chair that was on rails.
Und wir guckten, wie er dann auf uns zufuhr, dass man genügend Abstand hatte, um es zu kriegen.
And we had to see that we keep our distance because he was moving towards us.
Und mich stört sehr, und mein Mann auch, der immer sagt, Füße ab, wenn irgendwas nicht ganz drauf ist, dass die Füße leider nicht ganz drauf sind.
I am somewhat unhappy that I didn't get all of his feet into the picture.
Dann wäre das Bild noch besser.
That would have made it much better.
Yeah, got it.
Yeah. Yep. And so this is a figure, perhaps you could explain what this is,
okay,
for the non-art historians.
Okay. This is a disciple of Joseph Beuys. His name is Peter Heisterkamp, but known as an artist by the name of Blinky Palermo. He had come from East Germany as a young man. He was an adopted child with a rather tragic history. I had come from East Germany as a young man and studied in the academy in Düsseldorf, was a very close friend of Gerhard Richter's. And we see him here in front of one of his works called Schmetterling, Butterfly, at the installation in Darmstadt of the Ströer collection, as Barbara Klemm explained to me today, because I wasn't sure when it was taken or where it was taken. And that's 1970, and in 1970, once again, very few people, I would say, knew who Blinky Palermo was, and even fewer people would have taken the sculpture on the wall as a work to be taken very seriously. And Palermo had a very, very strong support and following, but a very limited following, and was basically an unknown artist. So once again, I was bewildered and puzzled when I saw the picture. I said, who would have taken a picture of Palermo in 1970. What a strange intuition you must have had to do this. So did you like the work or did you like the man? Because he was an extraordinarily charming person, very shy and very, I knew him quite well. So why on earth would you take that picture?
Ja, da war ich auch wieder auf die Kollegen angewiesen. Edward Bocan war unser Kunstkritiker und hat mich mitgenommen nach Darmstadt und hat gesagt, die bauen da die Ströer-Sammlung auf.
It depended on my colleagues here as well. So our art critic took me to Darmstadt and explained to me what they are doing there.
Und das schönste Bild dabei ist eigentlich Joseph Beuys geworden, wie er in einer Pause auf dem Boden sitzt.
And the best photograph I took there is that of Joseph Beuys himself, how he's sitting just on the floor.
Und dann sagte mir Bocall, und mach doch ein Bild von Blinky Palermo.
And then this art critic Bocall told me, well, take a photo of Blinky Palermo.
Und dann habe ich Blinky Palermo gefragt, und wie Sie sehen, auch da merkt man schon, wie schüchtern er war. Mm-hmm.
And so I asked him, and you can see how shy he was. Just look at his hands, how he holds his hands in the.
Es gibt noch ein zweites Bild von dieser Situation, wo er auf einer Leiter steht und an den Schmetterlingen etwas richtet.
There is one second image where he's up on a ladder and corrects something on his butterfly.
Aber ich glaube, da ist er mehr besser getroffen.
Okay. But it was not the work that attracted you to take the photograph.
Right.
Okay.
Could you perhaps, Benjamin, just briefly for the non-art historians and for me, explain the significance of the sculpture? Is that possible?
Do we have 45 minutes?
I'm in charge, so yes.
Well, that is a bit difficult to do, also because we don't really see that it has color. We don't see what materials it is made from. It's a relief that sits on the wall. It would really take a longer time than we have right now. I mean,
I will ask you when we have champagne.
Yeah, okay.
Well, then what I would like to do, I am conscious of the time ticking. What I would like to do is go back just to one more of your more political photos. Oh, did you want to say? Please do. Please, yes.
Das ist in Berlin im Gropiusbau. Josef Beuys, ganz klein unten, stehend, wie er auf sein Werk aufbaut. Hirsch mit
Schlag. Blitzschlag.
Mit Blitzschlag.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so here you see the inside of a building called Gropiusbau in Berlin. Down there is Beuys, and he is building his installation called Stag with a Lightning Strike.
Und mich hat natürlich gereizt die Arbeit von Borowski, die mit im Hut, der Hut, den auch natürlich Beuys immer trug.
And I was intrigued by the work by the artist Borowski, this what you see on the roof there, this figure with the hat that is the signature of Beuys.
Ja, und so ist dieses Bild.
And so that I got this, all these two things together, this is how this photo got made.
Okay.
So I just wanted to go back to this photo. This photo is, I think, extremely important politically. I realize it's a little bit hard to see. This was a somewhat improvised speech by the West German Chancellor Helmut Kohl, who is standing on the podium to the far right. And this speech is actually taking place in Dresden in East Germany. That is still a separate country at this point. But it's taking place in December 1989, and the wall has come down. And the people marching in the streets who have been chanting, "We are the people," have now started to chant as well, "We are one people." And already in December 1989, the end of the division of Germany is becoming apparent. And Helmut Kohl, who actually is Catholic from West Germany, spent almost all of his career in West Germany. This was actually one of the first extended visits that he made to East Germany. And this visit is extremely important because until he made this visit, he thought that it would take decades to unify Germany. But this visit was hugely important politically for Helmut Kohl. When he got to Dresden, when he saw the people saying, "We are one people," when he saw people waving West German flags, not East German flags, when again and again people came up to him and asked him to unify the country, he said to his advisors, "You know what? We don't have to wait 20 years for unification. As a matter of fact, this is a done deal. We can make this happen right away." And he realized he could be the chancellor of German unity. So this visit to Dresden in 1989 was hugely important. It was thrown together somewhat at the last moment. You can perhaps see it's not very well organized, the stage. And again, it's just amazing. I'm Benjamin, I would keep echoing that. It's amazing that you were there for moment.
How did you get there?
How did you get there? This is sort of the moment. Yeah. I'm going to have to talk to you about this later, because I actually have been looking for people who were in Dresden and heard this speech. And then, lo and behold, I saw this in the exhibit and realized you were one of them. So I would be interested in hearing how you decided to go to Dresden for this Kohl visit, and also about the feeling at this event, which I notice you've captured the flags. It was a moment of difficult transition where there had been kind of unity and opposition to the government, but then there was starting to be a fracturing of feeling into what is the correct response. Should we create a better socialism? Should we reform East Germany? Or should we unify as quickly as possible? So I would be interested to hear about your experiences on this evening.
Für mich war das natürlich ein ganz wichtiger Auftrag, die erste Reise von Kohl nach Dresden.
For me, of course, that was a very important job when Kohl took his first trip into East Germany and was there in Dresden.
Und es gab sehr viele Termine, wo er Modrow und andere Leute aus dem Osten getroffen hat. Konferenzen gab es.
So there were quite a few meetings and conferences. He met with Modrow, the then leader of East Germany.
Aber mich hat nur interessiert bei diesem Termin, was passiert, wenn Kohl zu den Ostdeutschen spricht.
But I was only interested on this entire trip, what is going to happen if Kohl addresses regular East German people.
Und ich habe mir am Nachmittag den Platz angeguckt, wo das stattfinden wird.
So in the afternoon I was there on that square where this event was held
ob
later.
Ob der Aufbau, den das Bundespresseamt dann macht, wo wir Journalisten zu stehen haben.
And I checked, the Federal Press Office had created some installation there for journalists to take photos.
Ob das ein guter Platz ist.
And I checked if that was a good position
oder
that they chose.
Oder ob man was anderes suchen muss.
Or if I would rather be somewhere else.
Aber es war sehr gut, weil ich sah die Ruine der Frauenkirche im Hintergrund, sehen Sie ganz.
But it was a very good spot because you see in the background the ruins of the Frauenkirche in Dresden.
Und so habe ich mich 3 Stunden vorher, bevor der Termin angesagt war, auf dieses Podest gestellt, und zwar in eine Ecke, wo ich nach der Seite und nach einer anderen Seite arbeiten konnte.
So I positioned myself on that pedestal for the journalists at a place where I could look in both directions, to the east, to the west, 3 hours before the actual event started.
Und bevor es losging, war eine ungemein aufgeheizte Stimmung.
And there was a very heated atmosphere before that whole thing started.
Wo die alten Kommunisten und die jetzt Anhänger von Kohl, die also nun hofften, das geht alles ganz schnell, kriegen wir den Anschluss zu dem Besten, sich fast geschlagen haben.
Because there was almost a clash, they almost beat each other up. The old communists on the one hand, who wanted to keep as much as possible of the old East Germany, and the younger generation, who were looking towards the West and wanted to reunite as fast as possible.
Und als Kohl dann endlich kam und anfing zu reden, war es eine ungemein, also auf, die Massen haben ihn wirklich versucht, also es war beängstigend,
and
die Reaktion.
And the response when Kohl came and started to speak was kind of frightening.
Und da muss ich Ihnen sagen, habe ich wirklich den Kanzler bewundert, wie er diese Rede gehalten hat.
And I must say, I did at that moment admire the Chancellor that he stayed there and delivered his speech.
Er hat sich nicht von der Masse auf, also er hat versucht, das Ganze zu drücken, zu dämpfen und nicht sich auf diese Woge geworfen.
He did not. He did not ride the wave that the masses wanted him to ride on. He tried to keep the masses down, to control the crowds.
Und ich habe bei dem 20-jährigen Jubiläum gehört oder gelesen in einem Interview, dass Kohl gesagt hat, das war für ihn die schwierigste Rede, die er in seiner Regierungszeit gehalten hat.
And I think 20 years later at an anniversary of the unification, I read somewhere that Kohl said this was the most difficult speech that he has ever delivered.
Und ich hatte den Eindruck, ich hatte Angst, was wird aus uns, also wenn wir wieder so stark werden, was mit dem Nationalismus. Das hat mich beängstigt.
And at the same time I was nourishing my own concerns. What is going to happen if Germany reunites and becomes that strong again? Is that gonna be another huge nationalist development?
Und manches hat sich ja gezeigt, dass es doch genügend schlimme Folgen gibt.
And
mit dem Fremdenhass.
The years thereafter have shown that there are quite a few very adverse consequences of these tendencies, like xenophobia, as it came out in the years after.
Well, Falcon, we have only about 10 more minutes, and I would like to take at least a couple questions from the audience. Although, as mentioned, this event is not over. We're going to go and have a toast next door and a reception upstairs, so you will also have the opportunity to speak personally to Frau Klemm. But I just wanted to say, before I take questions, you've been very modest in saying you had a lot of luck, but what it seems to me is that you had a very good ability to listen. There are many other photographers, but none has produced such a consistent and surprisingly intimate collection of photos of key moments one decade after another as your collection. And I think that what I'm hearing from you is you would say, well, the art critic said I should go and do this, or the political correspondent said I should go and do this. You actually listened and actually followed through and have established and have assembled a truly impressive lifetime of work as a result of your ability to listen and to be sensitive to key moments. So again, we only have about 10 minutes, but if there are a couple of questions that people would like to ask, sir, over there.
Yep. So I'd like to ask, do you take solely in black and white, or do you also
schwarz-weiß photos without
underlay? Nein, ich mache nur schwarz-weiß photos, weil ich das Gefühl.
I'm only making black and white photos.
Weil ich das Gefühl habe, es konzentriert sich mehr auf den Inhalt.
Because
und als Reportage-Fotografin ist mir das Wichtigste.
Because it is my feeling that then you focus more on the content, and as a photographer who is in the reportage tradition, this is, I think, what is important.
Und zu der Zeit, als ich anfing, gab es nur Schwarz-Weiß bei der Zeitung.
And then again, when I started, there was only black and white in newspaper photography.
Other questions? Yes, Charlie.
As I looked over the photos, I mean, we all see things we want to see. I was struck by the quality of irony in many of them. It's what I would call the Liza ironie. The irony of the great men against not so great. The picture you have with the posters upside down for the GDR. I mean, that angel behind the Bundestag. Yeah. Is not just an angel. If we go in the next room in the fog, it is a justice holding up a scale of a middle aged motif often, and the justice vis-a-vis the injustice of the wall. Do you? I don't know whether this comes out. It's certainly artful, but is it something you think about in composing photos? The ironic quality of many of them.
Ja, natürlich. Ich meine,
yes, of course.
Ich habe schon ein bisschen Humor in mir.
I do have a sense of humor.
Und ich beobachte gerne.
And I like to watch.
Und manchmal ist das Leben doch auch ganz vergnüglich oder es hat so Hintergründe.
And sometimes life is quite pleasant and subtle too.
Wenn mir das gelingt, einzufangen im Bild.
And if I manage to capture that in a photograph,
kann ich vielleicht andere mit erfreuen.
I may pass the pleasure on to others.
It hadn't been mentioned, so I thought it was worth emphasizing. It's a lovely quality.
Ich wollte es nur mal als eine wichtige Qualität
hier auf. Questions? Oh, from the Goethe Institute. We must give you preference, yes.
Well, knowing the exhibition, having it installed it with you and the wonderful team of the CES, there was one image that was very different to me. That's the East German Punks. Das Punk-Foto nebendran. Können Sie uns sagen, dass das wirkt sehr anders als das, was Sie sonst gemacht haben? Wie ist das entstanden?
So that photograph of the punks in East Berlin looks different from her other work, and could you please tell us what brought about this picture?
Ich muss gestehen, ich weiß nicht genau welches
Bild.
Oh, das war aber nach der Wende. Das war in Leipzig. Das nennt sich Wave Gothic. Und da tragen die alle. Kostümieren sich wunderbar und tanzen und machen so ein bisschen, ist etwas außerhalb meines Alters gewesen, aber auch das macht mir Spaß,
well, einfach die Last Line zu hängen. It is certainly outside of my age group, that photograph, and but let me just point out, this photo was taken in the East after the political change, so you what you can see is the change in the youth, among the young people as well. This was a Miss Gothica event that they were holding in Leipzig, and yes, sometimes I like to take photos like that too.
Aber es gab sehr viele Punks zu Zeiten der DDR. Also da haben die Kollegen im Osten auch ganz, gibt's ganz großartige Bilder.
But there have been punks at the time when there was still East Germany, and quite a few of my colleagues have taken photos of these people as well.
Sir, you had a question.
Sure. Would you please tell us about your most challenging assignment that you had?
Herausfordernd auch. Ja.
Ja.
Sure.
Sehr erstaunlich, aber es war die Reise vom polnischen Papst, die erste Reise nach Polen.
It is very, may surprise you, but it was the first trip of the Polish Pope back to Poland.
Und das war natürlich eine unglaubliche, auch politische Situation.
It was also at the same time an unbelievable political situation.
Das war ja bevor der Kommunismus fiel.
That was before the downfall of communism.
Und es waren Hunderttausende von Menschen, die zu den heiligen Messen im Freien kamen.
And there were hundreds and thousands of people who attended the open-air holy masses.
Und für uns Fotografen war der Papst immer sehr weit weg.
And the Pope was always very far away from us, the photographers.
Und die Kirche hatte so die Ordnungsmacht übernommen.
And the church had taken over the power of these events.
Und haben das sehr gründlich gemacht.
And they took control and were there very thorough.
Und ich kam mit vielen blauen Flecken nach Hause.
And I came home black and blue spots all over.
Aber es ist mir immer wieder geglückt, doch daran zu kommen. Und ich habe ein sehr wichtiges, für uns wichtiges Bild gemacht, den Papst in Auschwitz.
And I managed to get close every once and again, and I made a highly important picture for us, and that is the Pope in Auschwitz.
Und auch für mich war das erste Mal, dass ich in Auschwitz war.
And it was also my first time in this former concentration camp.
Und das hat mich sehr in Tränen gebracht.
And I was moved to tears, very much, very tearful that day.
That is a very apt example to end on. The director of our center, Grzegorz Eckhart, is from Poland and was involved in Solidarity. I don't know, Grzegorz, would you like to say anything about? No. He is also a photographer himself as well.
Yeah, I know. I saw your exhibition.
Yes.
It's wonderful pictures. It's color, aber fantastic.
That's cool. The photographer is praising your photographs, Grzegorz. Well, that is perhaps a wonderful note to end on. I realize that there are more questions, but actually now we are going to move to the gallery next door where we will have something lovely to drink, and Charlie Mayer and Christoph Mirror will give us a toast, and then we can go upstairs and the conversation can continue.
Yeah.
Please join me in thanking Ralph.